Unlike jazz performers, who are trained to be able to improvise in historical and contemporary jazz styles, many of us who are classically trained performers were given no instructions in how to improvise in Baroque or classical styles. Instead, most of us were taught from a young age to play only what was written on the score, with the 20th or 21st century expectation that if we follow the notational recipe on the page, our finished product will closely resemble what the composer had in mind. And to a certain extent, this may be true, although even a cursory examination of different performances reveals that no two performances are ever exactly alike, even when performed by the same person. And is this idea of teaching exact replication according to the composer's wishes even historically valid? Musicological research tells us that the further back we go in time, that the role of the performer becomes more of being a co-creator with the composer in bringing the performance to life. With this in mind, should we then train our 21st century students only to be exact copyists or replicators when performing Baroque and classical era music? What if we were able to instead provide them with guidance on how to creatively reimagine the music within the parameters of Baroque and classical style, with respect to adding ornamentation, or melodically improvising in repeated sections of the music, thereby encouraging creativity and individuality in our students? This video lecture will demonstrate some possibilities on how this could be done using standard piano teaching repertoire ranging from late beginning to early advanced levels. In my own lifelong musical journey, I have found that the hardest part for me with adding unwritten ornamentation or melodic improvisation was giving myself permission to do it without having to worry about lightning bolts falling from the sky and striking me dead or being arrested by the historical ornamentation police. In fact, composers of the 17th and 18th centuries would normally have expected we as performers should and would do this. So, permission granted. I can, however, imagine that Beethoven and many other 19th century composers might actually attempt to throw virtual lightning bolts at us if we start messing around with their stuff too much. The 19th century in Western Europe was far different than in the 17th and 18th centuries, and so was the music. So, for the purposes of this presentation, we are only discussing Baroque and classical era repertoire. The first issue I want to discuss is the concept of historical style. What you are seeing here is a manuscript of Bach's Fugue in C minor from the Well-Tempered Clavier, Book 1, in the hand of a copyist. The handwriting is quite beautiful. Notice that this score is devoid of any tempo, articulation, phrasing, and dynamic markings of any kind. This was fairly typical in most of the scores I have seen from the 17th century, as well as many of the scores from the early 18th century. The problem is that these types of notational symbols for us as modern game players give written instructions on what sort of style to play in, but this page doesn't have any. Now, before you think that this is just really weird that composers didn't bother to write in all this information into their scores, take a look at this score arrangement from the 21st century. It also doesn't have a lot of markings, with the exception of chord symbols or a forte in the pickup bar and a single slur in bar 29. Otherwise, it is also devoid of notational symbols of articulation and phrasing that could indicate some sort of style to us. From our 21st century point of view, however, the main difference between the score of the Star-Spangled Banner and the Bach Fugue is that this is a piece most of us have heard many times, sung a cappella by various people at sporting events, and so we know it quite well. We are comfortable with hearing it sung in one of our 20th or 21st century contemporary popular styles. Which brings up the question, how exactly is style notated? Let's use contemporary pop star Mariah Carey as an example. Does this score of our national anthem really convey the improvisational and ornamental aspects that characterize her unique singing style? Well, let's take a listen.
So firmly we held at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallant. Streaming and the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, came through the night that our flag was still.
Did this score notationally show her where to add those various types of embellishments to decorate the melody? Did this score tell her to improvise a new melodic ending to the piece? I think we could all agree here that the answer is an emphatic no. Rather, this basic score provided her with a simple background from which she could showcase her amazing creative improvisational skills. So where can we go to find out more information about Baroque and classical historical styles of music? We can't rely on audio or video recordings because this technology did not really exist before the early years of the 20th century. However, we can look for oral traditions that may have been passed down or surviving written documents that extensively describe Baroque or classical style. These historical sources contain a lot of information with regard to ornamentation, embellishment, and improvisation, where, when, and how to do it. They reveal to us that melodic improvisation was not only suggested, but expected, according to the talent, good taste, and ability of the performer. In this way, the performer was given an opportunity to be a co-creator with the composer, and there has never been an easier time in history than right now to search for this information from the convenience of your own home. Most of these historical documents are posted on the IMSLP archive and can be easily accessed for free, or can be purchased or downloaded to your iPad and other electronic devices. This is where we get direct source materials that describe in great detail elements of Baroque and classical style and provide examples of ornamentation choices that were idiomatic to the music of these time periods. What we see in some of the documents is that oftentimes a composer or teacher would write out examples of how melodic improvisation could be done. Here is such an example by J.S. Bach from his Saraband from the English Suite No. 2 in A minor, where he has written out an ornamented melody that is supposed to be played for the repeat. Gently swinging pairs of stepwise eighth notes, usually in medium tempos, is called inegale or inequality. And although there is evidence that the Italians, Germans, and English sources mention this unnotated tradition of swinging pairs of eighth notes, it is especially idiomatic to French Baroque music. So here we see on the right one of the most popular late beginning teaching pieces for keyboard, Jean-Philippe Rameau's piece Minuet en Rondeau, or Rondino, as it is sometimes called in many piano anthologies. On the left, you see the 1724 first edition of this piece, printed alongside Rameau's ornamentation table. When I first saw this, it got me thinking, why was this piece purposely printed side by side with the ornamentation table, right on the same page? Surely there must have been a good reason for this. At that moment, I realized that I could use this very accessible little gem of a piece, not just to teach evenness and control of the fingers to my students, but also stylistic concepts such as ornamentation and even inégal, using an additive, layered process. Let's take a look. This is a demonstration on how to historically bring back to life this familiar 18th century keyboard teaching piece by Jean-Philippe Rameau using an additive process. The first 8 bars will be played a total of 4 times. First, it is performed as a modern trained player would interpret the notation as it appears on the printed page, played straight with no particular inflection, articulation, dynamics, or phrasing. Next, the bass clef left-hand part is enlivened and animated with added articulation and phrasing that is influenced by the dance step choreography of the minuet, as implied by the very name of this piece. For the third repetition of the piece, note inégal, the French historical practice of swinging pairs of stepwise notes written in equal note lengths, is applied. The degree to which inequality can be applied is left to the performer's discretion and taste. It should be mentioned here that the unwritten notation of swinging pairs of eighth notes in jazz follows the same tradition as in Baroque music that was written in French style. This makes total sense when you consider that it was the French who settled New Orleans, Louisiana, where the early roots of jazz began. The final repetition shows examples of how ornamentation can be added to the melodic line, just like adding icing and sprinkles on a beautiful cake. These particular ornamentation choices were used because they sit easily in the position of the hand, but other ornamentation choices are certainly possible. Ornamentation can even be different every time, depending on the creativity and mood of the performer. To introduce you all to the acronym HIP, or HIP, which stands for Historically Informed Performance. I have also co-opted this acronym to mean Historically Informed Pedagogy, to which I believe is so important in learning about historical national styles and unwritten notational conventions of which we all need to be aware. Let us now talk about Clementi's famous teaching pieces, the Opus 36 Sonatinas, which were originally published in 1797. This Opus 36 subsequently went through more than 6 different published editions over a time frame of about 20 years. What you see here is a modern 2017 published version by Dr. Arthur Houle of Colorado Mesa University that is based upon Clementi's 1815 fifth edition. For those of you who are familiar with these sonatinas, you will notice that this fifth edition has been reimagined by Clementi himself, where he has revised or added many new elements into the score, most of them having to do with the extended range of the piano that did not yet exist when he first published them in 1797. But he made other changes too, that seemed to be added for no other reason than to mix things up a bit and to make it different than the original edition, as indicated with the blue arrows pointing to passage work changes in both Sonatinas 1 and 5. For most of us, the version of Clementi's sonatinas that we all learned as kids and that we teach from now are all based upon the first edition. But we see from this fifth edition that Clementi himself had no problems at all with the concept of changing, adding to, or updating his compositions. Therefore, this also gives me confidence with the idea of adding occasional ornaments or even doing a bit of stylistic melodic improvisation in slower movements where it would be most appropriate. Here are some ideas of what I've done with this piece with regard to added ornamentation or melodic elaboration that I feel would be appropriate to the abilities of students who are playing at an early intermediate level. This video is made so that students could have a bird's eye view of the hands and not the score. So if you want to follow along with your own score, just push the pause button now and run and grab it.
Thank you.
like to discuss one of the most famous piano teaching pieces of all, Mozart's Piano Sonata in C major, K545. It is one of the finest examples of a late intermediate level classical piece, and the first movement of this is currently listed in level 8 of the Royal Conservatory Piano Syllabus, 2015 edition. In faster tempos such as indicated for the first movement, there is not as much room for added ornamentation or improvisation. Nevertheless, there are places where it can be done, especially in repeated sections. I have chosen to take all of the repeats in this performance to demonstrate some ways of how it can be done. The beauty of having a virtual conference is that we don't have to sit in uncomfortable chairs all day long. So go ahead and curl up on your favorite cozy couch and take a moment for yourself just to relax and enjoy this piece. Thank you. Unlike the first movement, the slower middle movement provides more opportunities for adding melodic ornamentation, especially on repeats of sections. Additionally, I chose to add a bit of melodic improvisation to the coda section. I made this recording a few years ago, and listening back to it now, I feel like I could have chosen to add even more ornamentation in certain spots. It certainly is a fine line in determining whether one has added too much or not enough ornamentation in the moment of performance. Keep in mind that ornamentation and improvisation, by their very nature, are intended to be freely created and executed, and that we need not feel that our ornament choices need to stay the same from performance to performance.
Thank you.
Let us now return for a moment to the conversation about determining the proper style for Baroque and classical music. Determining a good range of tempo for the third movement has often been tricky, and many students and professional pianists end up playing it too fast. This movement is written in the style of a popular Baroque dance called a gavotte, which is characterized by starting on two upbeats where the dancers rise or kick upward before coming back down along with the downbeats in the music. What you are seeing here is a chart taken from a book written for modern dances studying historical dance styles. This shows them the typical melodic rhythms of a gavotte. The theme of the third movement of the sonata matches nearly identically with the lower two lines of the chart, which show the typical rhythmic patterns. Therefore, the choreography of the gavotte dance step can be used to determine a proper tempo for this movement, and there are many YouTube videos which demonstrate this type of dance step. One last piece which represents an early advanced level, the slow second movement of Mozart's Sonata in C Major, K330. Both the first and second movements of this piece are currently listed in Level 9 of the Royal Conservatory Piano Syllabus 2015 edition. This piece provides many opportunities for improvisation and ornamentation because of the numerous small sections with repeat, and it offers more advanced students an opportunity to develop a more sophisticated and individualized awareness of ornamentation possibilities that would be appropriate in classical style for this piece.